Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello and welcome back to the sixth tutorial session for Engineering Thermodynamics. The book that you are seeing, this is Thermodynamics and Engineering Approach by Senjal and Bowles. This is the book we follow at IIT Kanpur for undergraduate thermodynamics teaching. And I am Dr. Jishnu Bhattacharya, an associate professor in mechanical engineering at IIT Kanpur, where we also teach the same book for undergraduate thermodynamics teaching. Okay, so let's start. In last five tutorial sessions, we have looked at a few problems from each chapters, starting from chapter one, which is introduction and basic concepts. And then the second chapter was on energy, energy transfer, and general energy analysis. Okay, so these we followed for first two tutorials, first two chapters, and then the third chapter, which is properties of pure substances, where we have looked up different tables. We have seen that how to find different property values from the tables for pure substances like water, saturated water vapor, superheated water vapor, and then the refrigerant R134a. Also, the ideal gases like air or some other gases. And we have also looked at the real gas equations, what assumptions do we take for real gas and all. Okay, so this is the in the third chapter we have dedicated two tutorials because it took a lot of time for individual property readings. And then on the fifth tutorial, we have covered the chapter number four, which is energy analysis of closed systems. Closed systems means where mass cannot go in or out. So please follow the this mouse on the screen so that you know where I am pointing at. So chapter four was covered up to tutorial five. Now today we are doing the sixth tutorial session, where we will take few problems from the next chapter, which is chapter five. The title is mass and energy analysis of control volumes. Okay, so I am assuming that you have read through the theory part of it, and we are going to take few problems to understand the concepts clearly, okay, and how to apply them. So control volume and systems, these ideas I'm assuming you have, and whenever required I will shortly talk about them. And let's take up the first problem. Let me zoom this little bit so that you can also read it clearly. This is the first problem. What is the problem statement? An insulated vertical piston cylinder device initially contains 0.8 meter cube of refrigerant R134A at 1.4 megapascal and 120 degree centigrade. So on the right hand side, you can see the schematic diagram of the system. The whole thing is insulated, that means no heat transfer is happening, and this is a vertical piston cylinder arrangement. This is the piston, and it is also associated with a spring. So the initial condition of the in the cylinder for the gas, which is R134A, that's given. The volume is given, pressure is given, temperature is also given. Okay. Then next, it says a linear spring at this point applies full force to the piston. Okay, so initially, the spring is engaged. That's what it says. A valve connected to the cylinder is now opened. So please look at the right hand side. Here you can see a valve. I mean, there is a opening outlet and it was closed initially. Now you are opening that valve. So what will happen? Of course, this gas will go out, right? So the refrigerant is allowed to escape. The spring unwinds as the piston moves downward. Now as refrigerant escapes, the pressure drops. So the spring becomes stretched, right? So as the piston moves downward and the pressure and volume drop to 0.7 MPa and 0.5 meter cube. So you can see earlier it was 1.4 MPa. Now the after the gas escapes, the pressure comes down to 0.7 MPa. So half, it becomes half. And volume wise, the initial volume was 0.8 meter cube. Now the volume comes down to 0.5 meter cube. That means the piston comes down by a certain amount so that the volume becomes 0.5 meter cube at the end of the process. Okay. So at the if that's the process end, you fix for this process, you have to determine first the amount of refrigerant escaped. So you have to find out how much refrigerant you will lose. And the second one, part B, it asks that the final temperature of the refrigerant. Okay. So these are the two things you have to find out. So we have already discussed the schematic diagram, what is happening in the process. Now we have to note few things. Okay, first thing is that this is a control volume process. So up to the last tutorial, whatever we discussed, it was closed system, right? Nothing was flowing. So now we have an outlet for this particular piston cylinder arrangement. That means mass can move across the boundary. So it is a control volume system. You have to take the control volume, which is just covering the cylinder, the gas containing portion of the cylinder. And that particular control volume boundary, we'll see that here the mass will cross that boundary. Okay. So that's the basic difference from the problems we have looked at in earlier tutorials from this one. Okay, so first thing you note that this is an unsteady process, right? Because like as the gas moves out, the pressure drops, so the volume change, everything is changing with time, right? This is not a steady process. So it's depending on the time. And the condition of exit flow changes with time, right? So the pressure, volume, everything, whatever you are taking, pressure or specific volume, temperature of the gas that is escaping, that is changing with time because the condition inside the cylinder is also changing with time. And that's the condition the escaping gas will also have. So the condition of exit is changing, but it can be approximated by a uniform flow. Okay, so you can, what you can do, you can take an average of these conditions and say that okay, this is the final and initial, the difference happened in uniform flow. It's not a steady process, but you can take it as uniform flow. And if the exit flow condition you are taking, if you take that to be average of the initial and final conditions, okay? So that is possible. You can take it as a uniform flow, okay? So that's the first thing you have to know, that unsteady process, but we are making it, making assumption of uniform flow, which is reasonable. Okay, next thing you need to know, note that no heat interaction is happening. Okay, everything, the whole thing is insulated, so no heat interaction we have to consider. The third thing you need to know is the boundary work. Okay, so boundary work, where it is happening? Because we have a piston. Piston is moving up and down. That means it is boundary work that's happening also. Fourth thing is the piston cylinder arrangement, or the piston itself, is fitted with a linear spring. Okay, so boundary work can be computed by multiplying the change in volume by an average pressure. Okay, because it's a linear spring, so pressure will change linearly. So we can take it to be the average pressure, and we can find out the boundary work by multiplying that average pressure with the change in volume. Okay, the fifth thing that's happening is that for R134A inside the cylinder, the energy is internal energy. Okay, so whenever within a control volume, whenever things are not flowing, we have the energy is represented by the internal energy. Okay, but for the flowing fluid, which is escaping, the jet that is coming out through the valve, that is the energy is represented through enthalpy. So where to take internal energy U and where to take enthalpy H, that you have learned in the text in this chapter. So, but here we are just reminding you that whenever you take the fluid that is flowing, you have to take enthalpy, not energy. Okay. Now, the last point that you have to remember before you can solve this problem is that the system is a control volume. Okay, because mass is crossing the boundary. So that is a very important thing that you have to note in this problem. Okay, fine. So now, after getting the physical sense of what is happening and what kind of assumptions, what kind of concept you have to utilize, now we can actually go for the numerical solution. So first thing first, the initial condition, which is given to be pressure is 1.4 megapascal and temperature is 120 degree centigrade. It is R134A given. So you go and look up the table for R134A for this particular thing, and you will see that this is a superheated vapor condition that you will find. Okay. And corresponding to that condition, the specific volume small V1 will be 0.02039 meter cube per kg. And the specific internal energy U1 is 323.57 kilojoule per kg. And we will also need the H1 corresponding to the same pressure and temperature, which is 352.11 kilojoule per kg. Now, why do you need at the initial condition both U and H? Because for the gas which is contained in the cylinder, that for that we'll use U, and the part of the gas that is moving out of the cylinder, for that we'll use H. So both these values we will require. Okay. Now, if we do the balancing, first the mass balance, mass has to be conserved. So whatever coming in minus whatever going out, that should be the change in mass of the system. Okay, m in minus m out will be equal to delta m system. Okay, now nothing is coming in. So whatever be that, so what is coming out, that is ME, or M escaping. S for escape, we are using term or the letter E. ME will be equal to the change in system, delta M system, that is M1 minus M2. Okay, so this is nothing but the escape mass will be equal to the difference of initial and final mass. Okay, so that's the mass balance. So the next thing that we do is the energy balance, and that's the critical part. So what terms do we have? First, we have the boundary work that is happening due to the movement of the piston. Okay, so that's the work that is happening on the system. And now what energy is escaping? We have to minus that or subtract that. That's mass, the total enthalpy of the exit flow. That means ME into HE, whatever be the average enthalpy of the exit flow, that has to be multiplied by the escape mass to get the total enthalpy going out of the system. And this energy has to be balanced by the change in internal energy of the gas that is contained in the cylinder. That means M2U2 minus M1U1. Okay, the small u, they represent the specific internal energy. That's why we are multiplying them with respective masses. Okay, now here work is applied on the control volume because the piston is moving and the spring is pushing that piston. Okay, so moreover, there is no other energy which we could have taken is the kinetic energy of the exit flow, but usually that kinetic energy is very small. That's why we can neglect that. Okay, so the energy balance is boundary work minus the escaping enthalpy or the energy of the flow will be equal to the difference of internal energy for the remaining gas. Now we have seen the equations. Now we have to find out the numerical values. So M1, that's initial mass, will be total volume V1 divided by the specific volume at that initial condition. Okay, so the total volume 0.8 meter cube is given at the initial condition, and we have looked up the specific volume from the table, which is 0.02039 meter cube per kilogram. So by dividing it, you will find it to be 39.24 kilogram. So that's the initial mass in the cylinder. Okay, the next thing is the final mass, which is M2 will be equal to final volume divided by the final specific volume. So final volume is given here, 0.5 meter cube, but the specific volume at final condition, we don't know because the final condition itself is not given. So this thing is not known yet. So let's see how to proceed. What else do we know? We know the boundary work because we know the initial and final pressure, and we have assumed that it's a linear spring. So we can take the average of these two pressures and multiply it with the change in volume V1 minus V2. So here all the quantity we know, pressure 1, pressure 2, volume 1, volume 2. So we just substitute them and find out the boundary work at the piston boundary is 315 kilojoule. Okay, so this we know. So now if we put in the energy balance, whatever we know, let's put them in the energy balance. This is the WB term we just found out, minus MEHE, right? Now ME, how do we know? This is the initial mass. So this meter cube won't be there, that's wrong. And this is the initial mass in kg, and minus this 0.5 meter cube, that's the final volume divided by the specific volume. As we don't know the specific volume at final state, we could not find out the numerical value. And the whole thing is multiplied by HE. So this is the MEHE term. Now on the right hand side, we have M2U2 minus M1U1. Now M1 we know, okay, 39.24 kilogram, and U1 also we have looked up 323.57 kilojoule per kg. But we neither know the final state, so that's why we don't know the U2 as well as the specific volume at final state V2. So in this equation, see what are the unknowns. Unknowns are specific volume V2, specific internal energy U2, and the HE, which is the enthalpy of the escape flow. So now, as we have assumed that we will take the condition of the escape gas to be the average of the initial and final. So we'll take it H1 plus H2 divided by 2. That's the average, right? Now H1 we know. We know the initial condition, and we looked up the value from the table. So we know what is the H1. But H2 we don't know yet, okay? So basically the unknowns we are having is V2, U2, and H2. All we know if we know the final condition or the state of the final, the gas of the final cylinder, okay? Now let's see how we can find that out. Let me unzoom a little bit. Yeah, so now all these unknowns are known when we can find the state of the final gas. For that, pressure is given. Okay, pressure is given to be 0.7 megapascal, but temperature is not known. That is the problem. Okay, so here we don't have any other option but trial and error. So you can expect that this kind of problem you will not see in an exam, but here, as in a tutorial, we can do this, and it's time consuming. Otherwise you can also do that in an exam. So here we are going to use trial and error. We have to see for which temperature that particular energy balance equation is satisfied. Okay. So we have to guess a temperature and see whether the energy balance is satisfied. If not, we have to change the temperature guess and do it again. Okay. So I'm just giving you the final value of it. So for T2, or the final temperature to be 96.2 degrees centigrade, we will get the mass of the, basically what we will get is the state 2, that means the specific volume we will know, the specific internal energy we will know, and specific enthalpy that we will also know, V2, U2, H2, okay? And from that we will know, from the mass balance we will know what will be the escaping mass, that would be 26.8 kilojoule, kg. And then the mass that will be left in the tank or cylinder, that will be 12.47 kilogram, okay? And the final temperature that we just got by trial and error, that's 96.2 degrees centigrade. So these are the two quantities that you were supposed to find out. Okay, so in this problem, we have seen that, an unsteady problem was assumed to be a uniform flow problem, and we have solved it with the mass balance as well as energy balance, okay? The final state we didn't know, particularly the temperature, so we had to do some trial and error, and finally we obtained the final temperature as well as the gas that escaped from the system. Okay, so Let us now take the next problem, which is not with refrigerant R134a, but with steam or water. Okay, and that is, now you will see some direct practical application of this thermodynamics, which earlier was not very evident. Okay, so the problem that we'll take, that is a problem of steam turbine. Okay, whenever we have a thermal power plant, there we use steam turbines, which takes high pressure, high temperature input steam, and that turbine blades are moved by the input steam energy of that, and we convert it to a shaft work, and then we convert it through a generator, we convert it to a into the electrical energy. Okay, so we will see an application of thermodynamics in these steam turbines. So what is the statement of the problem? That steam enters a steady flow turbine. Let me zoom this little bit. Yeah, so steam enters a steady flow turbine with a mass flow rate of 13 kg per second at 600 degree centigrade and 8 megapascal and a negligible velocity. So velocity is given, that we don't have to worry about the kinetic energy of it. We can only take the enthalpy of it. Okay, for that we are given the pressure, temperature and all. Okay, and also the mass flow rate is given. The steam expands in the turbine to a saturated vapor at 300 kPa. Okay, so the exit, so it's a two-stage turbine. Okay, so you can see on the right hand side that this is a two-stage turbine. So first stage, it expands the steam fractionally, and then what it says, the steam expands in the turbine to a saturated vapor at 300 kilopascal, where 10% of the steam is removed for some other use. Okay, so we'll see when you learn more about power plant engineering, we'll see that steam at little high temperature and pressure we often require for maintaining or running other systems. Okay, for regeneration or some other aspects. So for that, 10% of the steam is removed, and then the remainder of the steam continues to expand to the turbine exit. So the next stage of the turbine takes the rest of the steam and it expands the steam to a pressure of 10 kPa. So pressure comes down. It was 8 MPa, very high pressure, and then it comes down to 10 kPa. Even less than atmospheric. Atmospheric pressure is 100 kPa, right? Approximately 1 bar is 100 kPa. So it is 1/10 of the atmospheric pressure it expands to. And the quality is 85%. Quality means at the exit, the vapor quality. That means 85% of that water vapor mixture will be vapor and 15% will be water. So if the turbine is adiabatic, that means no heat interaction is happening, determine the rate of work done. Okay, so turbine is actually moving this shaft, and that's the work done, W dot. What is the rate of work output? That's you have to find out. And what are given? That for the first stage, the state of inlet is given, 8 megapascal, 600 degree centigrade, 13 kg per second, all these things are given. And then in the first stage, 10% of that amount, from 13 kg, 1.3 kg, we are taking out as saturated vapor. That's also given. And the rest, 90%, is going to the second stage, and outlet condition of that stage is also given. So here we have to note that the turbine is adiabatic. Okay, so no heat exchange is happening. Second is, it's a steady flow energy equation problem, because earlier, for the last problem we have seen, the exit condition is changing. But here, no condition is changing. Everything is available at the same condition all the time. So that's a steady flow problem. The third thing is, the velocity is given to be negligible. So the kinetic energy part, we don't have to consider. Okay, so these are the notes that we have to first make. What are the physical things that we have to understand? Okay, now we are looking at the control volume problem, right? So let's take this dotted line tells us the control volume. Okay, we take control volume is an imaginary volume, right? So we can take it anywhere. So we are taking it in such a way so that the boundary conditions we know. So for the first one, the first boundary, we know what is the inlet condition. And here the second boundary, which is crossing the control volume, that's the fraction of that steam is getting escaped. So the control volume boundary value, that we also know. And the third boundary interaction or outlet that we get is the exit from the last stage of the turbine. Okay, that also we don't know. And another thing is crossing the boundary of this control volume is the work, the shaft work, that's actually going to the generator. Okay, so this work we also need to consider. Now, if we look at the control volume and we apply the steady flow energy equation, what we get? That whatever energy is coming in, that has to go out, because it's a steady flow, nothing can be stored. So what is coming in? That's the M1, H1. So, yeah. So what is coming in at the first inlet? That's M1 dot H1. Okay. So H1 is the flow energy per unit mass, and M1 is the mass flow rate. And that has to be equal to whatever is going out. What are going out? At boundary 2, M2 H2 is going out. At boundary 3, M3 dot H3 is going out. And at the work boundary, we also have W out dot. That's the work that's going out of the boundary or the control volume. So this has to be satisfied. Now, what is given among M1, M2, and M3? What is the relation? M2 dot is given to be 10% of M1 dot. That means 0.1 into M1 dot. And M3 is the rest. That means 90% or 0.9 of M1 dot. So if we replace this, we can simplify the energy equation here. So M1 dot H1 will be equal to 0.1 M1 dot H2 plus 0.9 M1 dot H3 plus W out dot. So from here we can find W out will be equal to M1 dot into H1 minus 0.8H2 minus 0.9H3. Okay. So now we know work output in terms of these enthalpies, specific enthalpies, and the original mass flow rate M1 dot. But we don't know what are the H1, H2, H3, all these things. Okay, M1 is given. So we have to look up tables for that. Okay, so H1, the inlet condition is given to be 8 megapascal and 600 degree centigrade. For superheated steam, you can find what is the enthalpy of that superheated steam. That's 3642.4 kilojoule per kg. Now, the second condition which is going out, it is given that it's saturated vapor. That means X2 is 1, and the pressure is also given, that's 0.3 MPa. Okay, before it expands to 10 KPa, intermediate stage, you are taking out some steam, right? So this P2 will be 0.3 MPa. So again, at this condition, saturated vapor at 0.3 MPa, you can find out the H2, that's 2724.9 kilojoule per kg. Now, what else we need to find here? This is the quantity, H3, right? So let's go and find it out. So the last condition that's given at state 3, the pressure is 10 kPa and the quality of vapor is 0.85. So H3 we can find out, HF at 10 kPa plus X, that's the vapor quality, into HFG at 10 kPa. So both of these HF and HFG at 10 kPa we can find out from the table. Okay, we just put those values and get H3 to be 2225.1 kilojoule per kg. Okay, so now we know all of these H1, H2 and H3, and we are given with the mass flow rate at the first stage or the inlet stage of the turbine. That's 13 kg per second. So all of these we know, and we can find what is the work output. So it comes out to be 17,776 kilowatt, and you can write it in terms of megawatt, that's 17.8 megawatt approximately. Okay, so if there is no losses, the turbines are like converting the whole of the enthalpy change into work output, then you can obtain 17.8 megawatt. But as you will see later, that no turbine on Earth can convert it fully. It will have to have some efficiency factor or certain losses. So the shaft work will be less than that. But modern days turbines can have efficiency more than 90%. Okay. So you can expect at least above 15 megawatt power to be obtained from this turbine if you have the steam inlet and outlet conditions as given in the problem. Okay, so this is a problem we have looked at, which is on a steady flow turbine energy balance equations we have looked at, and the complications came through a certain intermediate mass taken out, as well as there are two stages. So all these things you have to consider, but the basic concept stays the same. So for flow, we have to consider enthalpy to be the energy content of the flow, okay, and the control volume concept. So what are the boundaries, what are the inlet and outlet, and also if certain work or heat is going in and out through the boundary, that we have to see. Here it was given that the whole thing is insulated or adiabatic, so that's why we did not consider, or we need not consider, anything related to heat, but we considered the work that's going out through the turbine shaft. Okay, so let us take the next problem for today's tutorial. Another practical problem we are going to take, which is on a pressure cooker. Okay, that you see every day at home. So a 4-liter pressure cooker has an operating pressure of 175 kPa. So you can see whenever you put pressure cooker on the burner and put water inside, after a certain time, the pressure cooker CT blows off, right? So that means the pressure inside the cooker has reached certain value, and that's why it lifts the valve and the you hear the sound, right? And water vapor comes out. And that is the operating pressure. You cannot take the pressure cooker, the inside steam of the pressure cooker at a higher pressure, because if it goes higher, it will come out automatically. Okay, so that is called the operating pressure. And this pressure cooker that we are talking in this problem has an operating pressure of 175 kilopascal. So initially, one half of the volume is filled with liquid. Okay, so you don't fill the whole pressure cooker with water, right? You certainly fill maybe half. So in this case, it is one half of the volume is filled with liquid and the other half with vapor. Okay, of course, at equilibrium, it has to be other half will be vapor. So if it is desired that the pressure cooker does not run out of water for 1 hour, so you cannot just allow the pressure cooker to be there all the time, because the water will run out and whatever you have put to get it cooked, that will burn, right? So you have to note that for how long the water will sustain there. So here it is saying that the pressure cooker does not run out of water for 1 hour. It has to sustain it for 1 hour. And for that condition, you have to determine the highest rate of heat transfer allowed. That means how much heat you can input through the burner. What is the rate? Q dot in. Okay, so this is the schematic diagram of the pressure cooker. Initially, it has the volume 4 liter and the pressure is 175 kPa. You are putting heat in and the steam comes out when the CT goes off. Okay. So just like the first problem, this is also an unsteady problem. This you notice that the steam comes out intermittently, right? It does not come out all the time at the same rate. So this is also an unsteady problem, but again, we can analyze it as a steady problem. We can assume that the amount of mass that is coming out as steam is coming out slowly at the same rate. Okay, because the outgoing mass has always the same condition. Okay, it does not change with time. Whenever it comes in, it comes out, it comes out at the same condition. Now, again, you note that this is a control volume problem because mass is crossing the boundary. Here also, steam is crossing the boundary of the control volume. So this is a control volume problem. And the third thing you need to note that energies of unflowing and flowing mass are represented by the internal energy U and enthalpy H respectively, okay? So whenever steam is inside the cylinder or the cooker, you have to consider its internal energy U. But whenever it is coming out, you have to consider the enthalpy of it. Why is that? That also we'll see through the problem itself. Okay. So now we have to go through the same process of mass balance and energy balance. So mass balance is again, whatever is escaping will be equal to M1 minus M2. Whatever inside at the initial state and then whatever is left, M1 minus M2. Okay, and energy balance, again, now we don't have any boundary work. Okay, what we saw in the first problem in the piston cylinder device, here we don't have boundary work, but we have heat crossing the boundary, right? So heat input that's happening through the burner, that minus whatever is escaping, that means ME into HE. This much energy is escaping out of the control volume through the blowing of steam. Okay, and that has to be equal to the balance of internal energy left. Okay, so that means M2U2 minus M1U1. So here, what assumption we are making? That boundary work for lifting the valve, we are not considering that. That's a negligible, of course. For lifting the valve, you are doing certain work against the gravity, but that's negligible. And also, the kinetic energy of the outgoing steam is negligible. So these two we are assuming. Now we know the mass balance is ME equal to M1 minus M2, and energy balance is Q in minus MEHE equal to M2 U2 minus M1 U1. Now we need to find out the numerical values of these quantities. So initial state is, it's given, it's a two-phase thing, and half of the volume is liquid and half of it is vapor. Pressure is also given, 175 kPa. So you just look up what are the specific volume of full liquid or saturated liquid, that's Vf, and you also look up the specific volume of saturated gas. Okay, so correspondingly you look up the specific internal energy of saturated liquid and saturated vapor. Now it is given that half of volume is occupied by vapor, so we need all these pieces of information to find M and U. Okay, so we'll see that in a while. So now the final state, it's given that no liquid vapor. Okay, it says that how long will it take so that the water, I mean the cooker, does not run out of water. That means liquid water. So the final state is given indirectly, that no liquid water, that means only liquid vapor, water vapor is available inside the pressure cooker. And the final pressure is also the same, 175 kPa, but in this case we have saturated vapor. So again, the specific volume V2 is nothing but the Vg, or specific volume of saturated vapor at 175 kPa, that you can look up. And U2, that's the Ug, that means specific internal energy of the saturated vapor at 175 kPa, that also you can look up. Okay, now the outgoing steam, what is the condition? That's the same condition as the final state of the vapor, right? Whenever it reaches that condition, it goes out, the extra vapor. So the condition does not change. So from that condition, we can find the escaping enthalpy, HE, which is also appearing in the energy balance equation. HE is equal to HG, or specific enthalpy of saturated vapor at 175 kPa. And that is also you can look up. Okay, so all these values you can look up. And what thing you require for getting the mass balance correctly? So this M1 is nothing but MF plus MG. So the initial condition is half of. So we take capital Vf by small Vf plus capital Vg by small Vg. And all of these quantities are given. The specific volumes we looked up, and we can find the total mass at the initial condition. That's 1.895 kilogram. Okay, so now we can also find what is the M1 U1. Okay, so initial, the U1 is not a single state, it's a two-phase mixture. So it will be equal to MF UF plus MG UG. And MF UF we just found out from here. And we have also looked up UF UG. So you can find M1 U1. And the mass at the state 2, at the end, the final state, that's capital V over small v. Again, everything is given. We can find what is the M2. So we can see the initially the mass was 1.895, so almost 2 kg. And now we have only 4 gram, 0.004 kg, that means 4 gram. So from 2 kg, it comes down to 4 gram. All the rest goes out. Okay, so what mass is escaping? You just find the difference. 1.891 kilogram. Now in the energy balance also, we know all the terms in the right hand side. So we can find Q in, or how much heat we are putting through the burner. So that's 4188 kilojoule. Okay. Now if this heat addition happens in 1 hour, we can find out what is the rate of heat addition. Rate of heat addition is same. So if you keep the burner at the same level, so it will add the heat at the same rate. So that means you can find the the rate of heat addition, that's Q in dot, that's total Q divided by delta T. Okay, so 4188 kilojoule divided by 1 hour means 3600 second. So you can find out it to be 1.163 kilowatt. So that's the rate of heat you are adding through the burner to the pressure cooker. Okay, so this problem again, we have taken a problem where we are assuming the unsteady flow with a uniform flow problem. And we are doing mass and energy balance and finding out each individual properties from the table. We could find out what would be the individual mass and everything, how the mass balance is happening, and then the total amount of heat that is added, and from that the rate of heat addition. Okay, now we will take up the last problem for this tutorial, where we will take a gas, not saturated liquid water or saturated superheated water vapor or refrigerant. We will take a gas. In this case, we will take helium. So a rigid insulated tank that is initially evacuated is connected through a valve. So this tank is initially evacuated. Now we are connecting it to a supply line of helium. Okay, so the supply line, it carries helium at 200 kilopascal and 120 degree centigrade temperature. Okay, so high pressure, high temperature helium gas is flowing through this supply line, and we are just adding, we are trying to fill up this tank which is initially evacuated by opening up this valve. Now the valve is opened and the helium is allowed to flow into the tank. Of course, it's high pressure, so it will come inside the tank until the pressure reaches 200 kPa. So now the pressure will equilibrate until it reaches the 200 kPa, and at this point the valve is closed. Okay, so now this tank is filled with helium at 200 kPa. Now we have to find out what is the flow work of the helium. So there will be flow work, okay, as well as the internal energy part. So the total energy will be the enthalpy content of this supply line helium. Okay, so it is asking you to find out the flow work part of that. Okay, and the helium of the helium in the supply line, and the final temperature of the helium in the tank. So once the tank is filled, what would be the final temperature? And it is also given that it's insulated, so no heat is getting leaked to the ambient. Okay, so insulation is a key point you have to remember, otherwise it will be a much difficult problem. Now the flow energy of the supply line is getting converted into internal energy of the gas in the tank. Okay, so the flow energy, that means the enthalpy, which consists of the internal energy content of the supply line as well as the flow work. Okay, so both of that is coming inside, and ultimately this is not a flow system, so it is getting converted into the internal energy of the gas. So that energy balance we have to solve. So for the supply line, the input stream has the same condition, right? It does not change all the time, it's staying the same, but the tank is seeing an unsteady process, right? It initially was evacuated, and then the pressure slowly builds up. So pressure, temperature, everything is changing with time. So it is seeing an unsteady process through which the state of contained gas is getting changed. True? So now, if we take the equilibrium at the end, when we are closing the valve, at that time the pressure is equilibrated and there can be no more flow of the gas. So we have reached the equilibrium. So if we take that equilibrium point, we can say the energy has to be balanced, right? So the internal energy of the tank has to be balanced by the enthalpy of the supply line, which is the flow energy. So this internal energy of the tank, we can write the specific heat at constant volume into the temperature of the tank, right? Cv into absolute temperature of the gas of the tank, that will be equal to the H line. H line is Cp, that means specific heat at constant pressure multiplied by the absolute temperature of the supply line. Okay, and from that we can find the T tank, or the temperature of the gas inside the tank, will be equal to Cp over Cv into T line, supply line, right? So this is simple. But it also asked, what is the flow work of the supply line? Flow work, how we know? We know it by the pressure multiplied by the specific volume. That's called the flow work, right? So for specific volume, what we need? We need to use the ideal gas law. And for that, we also need to find out the properties. So we have to look up the property tables, and we should find the R, the gas constant for helium, the Cp, Cv, all these values we can look up. Okay. Now the specific volume we obtain by using the ideal gas law, which is the gas constant for helium, absolute temperature of the supply line divided by the pressure. Okay. So all of these we know. This absolute temperature you have to convert 120 degree by adding 273 degree to make it in Kelvin, and the specific volume you will find 4.0811 meter cube per kg. Okay, and the flow work will be pressure into specific volume. That's 200 kPa into 4.0811 meter cube per kg, and the flow work will be 816.2 kilojoule per kg. Okay, that's the flow work. But the flow energy is different. That's the enthalpy. So you have to add the internal energy part to it to get the flow work, flow energy. So now the temperature we know, the Cp, Cv we found out or looked up from the table. We know the temperature of the line, and the tank temperature we will find to be 382 degrees centigrade. Okay, so here you note that the temperature inside the tank is much higher compared to the supply line. Supply line was having 120 degrees centigrade, but the temperature of the gas in the tank is 382, so it's much higher. So from where this higher temperature is coming, or higher internal energy is coming? Because this flow work is getting converted to the internal energy. That is why the temperature is much higher. So with that, I complete this session of the tutorial, where we have covered four problems from chapter 5 of the Senjel and Bowles book. So see you in the next tutorial. Thank you.